Good evening. Welcome to Diversity of Wider Vision. I'm Joseph Amprey. And tonight's program will focus on summer activities for tots, teens, and young adults. School's out, and many parents and families are concerned about things they can do this summer with their young people to keep them learning and being constructive. I have two people here tonight, two experts, who work with programs that you can get involved with. I'd like you to meet Mr. Matt Lubas, who's Recreational Supervisor for the Reading Recreation Commission. Matt, thanks for coming.
Thank you.
Also here is Rebecca Hughes, the Recreational and Cultural Manager for the Berks County Parks and Recreation, or actually it's called Berks County Recreation and Parks. Mm-hmm. Thanks for coming. I'm going to ask each of you to talk about some of the things you do during the summer and also all year round for young people. Matt, what kind of activities have you guys planned for young people this summer?
We got a pretty busy summer going on right now. Today was the first day for our summer program system. Our playground system started today. I'm happy to say that most of the playground programs are full, which means we have a lot of kids out enjoying them. I will say that at Keffer Park, Hillside, and Barbie's, there's still some openings. Those programs run 12:30 to 5, Monday through Friday. The children get in at 12:30. We serve them lunch. We get them started off right each day.
Wow.
So it's an exciting time. The attendance has been great so far, so we're excited about that. But there are still some openings, so if you're interested in anything that I talk about today, you can feel free to call the office, which is 610-655-6201. We also have our website, readingrec.org, that you can go and find out more about things like that. So we're really excited about the playground program going on. The other thing, it's hot out, so the big thing right now is the pool over at Schlegel. Been very busy since the weekend has started. It is a public pool, so you can come and pay as a day guest at $6 for anyone four and over. We do have memberships for families, very affordable. So if you're hot, you need to get a little bit cool, it's a great place to come and enjoy the water. And we also have a very intensive tennis program, which actually runs off of the playground program. That's an afternoon program. The tennis program runs in the morning out of Hampton Park and Albright College. So it's a great complement. So if you're looking to get your kids involved in some activities, we've got some great things for you going on.
If you have questions, you can call us. We're live tonight, Monday the 12th. We're on from 8 until 11:50. The number to call is 610-378-0426. Again, that's 610-378-0426. So Becky, what kind of programs are there available at the Berks County Recreation and Parks this summer?
Well, we have lots of programs for all sorts of different ages. Anything from environmental education to history camp that we have in July. We are doing a program for the summer solstice on June 21st. So it should be a fun program. We'll have music and songs and a campfire and kids crafts and things like that. We have a program book that lists all of our programs, so if you want to pick one of these up, you can come in to any of our programs that we have. We have a history camp that comes up in July then as well. So
is there any cost?
There's no cost for a lot of our programs. Some of our programs cost $5 or a minimum fee, but it lists it on our website or in our book.
And the number to call is?
610-374-8839.
Now, you mentioned a summer solstice, June 21st.
Yes.
For those of us who aren't astronomers, what is a summer solstice?
It is the longest day of the year, and it's when the summer officially begins. The unofficial summer, I guess, was Memorial Day weekend. So we are going to celebrate the sun, and the Berks County Astronomy Club will actually be there to tell people all about the sun. And they have special glasses and telescopes so you can look at the sun, which is cool.
So sounds like fun, huh?
We'll have all sorts of things.
One thing I find fascinating is that we generally think of culturally as summer starting Memorial Day and ending Labor Day. But the astronomers tell us that summer starts June 21st. As you said, it's the longest day of the year. And surprisingly, after the 21st, the days get shorter and shorter and shorter until December 21st. So that then again, they get longer and longer until June 21st. And of course, around September 20th and around March 20th, we have what we call equinox, which means that there are 12 hours of sunlight and 12 hours of daylight, and that's kind of even. I forgot to ask you, Matt, for the playgrounds, is there any cost?
There is. It's $55 for the entire summer. That is an 8-week program, 5 days a week, I think, and that includes field trips that they take. They do, each playground attends Schlegel Pool at least twice during the summer. They also go bowling. They've gone to laser tag. And we have some different things going on at some of our playgrounds. We do have an art camp, which is run out of Pandora Park. We have a sports camp out of Barra Park. And then our other playgrounds are just general playgrounds. They do a little bit of everything. So if you have a specialty, it's great. If not, you know, we cater just about to anyone.
Fascinating. Now, some of the programs are full already, so that if you haven't already
we have a couple playgrounds still open. Like you said, Barbie's is one. We partnered with Gilmore Henny over at Barbie's this summer, so we are running that program, and Keffer Park, and Hillside. So there still are some spaces available. We had a big rush towards the end of last week. I think people started thinking, school's out, what am I going to do with my child? So we did get a big rush towards the end of the week. But you still have time if you want to come down to the office at 3rd and Spruce or give us a call. We can let you know some different things that are still available. The tennis program, there's room in that. So, you know, if your child is new or maybe a little more competitive, we got stuff for all ages. We have stuff for adults. In the evening as well. So if you're looking to get out and get some exercise, we have beginners, intermediate to advanced. So we'll find a group for you, which is great. And the other thing that we have going on over at the pool is our swim lesson program, which starts next week. We run 3 2-week cycles. So if you think you need to get some lessons for your children or feel a little more comfortable around the water, we certainly have some openings for that as well. So reasonable cost. It's a total 8 lessons, small group lessons, $35. You won't find anything better than that. We have great staff that run it, so it's very important, especially as it gets hotter. Your kids are in and around water. We want to make sure everyone's safe out there this summer.
And you would probably say that the earlier, the better in terms of learning to swim.
Absolutely. Absolutely. We hear, unfortunately, people going down to the river when it gets hot and going in places, and it's just not the safest place to be. And if you're not a good swimmer or even an intermediate swimmer, you can get yourself in trouble. So we think it's very important to get your child in early. They don't have to be great swimmers, but they really need to be able to be safe around the water. That's probably the most important thing you can do, is make sure your child is safe around the water.
Oh, that's good advice. I'm going to read some programs that are available now. The YMCA has some summer camps. The camps at Robinson Elementary, Riflin, at Adamstown, Reading, of course, Tri-Valley, Tanaqua, Sinking Spring, and Wyoming Hills. And there's a cost of $80 per child. And most camps run from 6:30 a.m. to 6 p.m. daily. So you can call the Y. And get started. I'll give you the Reading Y, which is 610-378-4700. But they're all available, lots of Y camps, so try to get your youngsters involved if they aren't already. There's also some camps, other camps that are available that have been put on the website. If you go to the Reading website, you can find camps at Spruce Summer Camp, the Athletic Focus Camp, the Brooks Ballet Theater has a group, and so there are all kinds of camps. If you just go onto the Reading Eagle website, you can find out about 10 or 15 different camps that young people can get involved in during the summer. And we just feel that if young people are involved in something that's constructive, they're better people. They feel better about themselves, and they're less likely to get in trouble. So please take advantage of all the opportunities that are available. I'm going to ask Matt and Becky if they would talk about how things have changed. They're both much younger than I am, and I work with college students. I see some significant change in terms of attitudes and values. What are some things that you've noticed? And you've been around about 19 years in this business, haven't you, Matt? How are things different now than they were, 19 years ago? Will take us back into the latter part of the 19th century, back about, let's say, 1998, 97. What was it like then compared to now?
Well, I think, and we were talking a little bit before we came in today, just about how our program is structured. The original, what you consider, when I talk to folks who were in the playground system, you could just come, drop into the playground, leave if you want, come back in the afternoon. It's a little different now. It seems we have, you know, parents working now or two-income families, so when they drop their child off at the playground, you can't leave. You need to be signed out. And I think that's just parents don't want their kids going back home. It's a technology society, and I think we all want our kids outside and doing things. So, you know, I think, you know, making sure that your child is somewhere constructive is very important. So the days of just dropping in and dropping out are no longer. You know, you do need to sign in and sign out each day so your parents know you're there all day long. When they're done with work, they come back and pick you up, or you're able to walk home at that time. But they want to know that they're being taken care of throughout the day. And the other thing we talked about is just, you know, liability, general liability. It's kids just walking up to a program, we just can't do it anymore. Fortunately, we're in a litigious society. We need to make sure that our kids are safe and everyone's around them that's safe. So, you know, I think it's that's one of the changes that I've seen since I've started.
Matt mentioned that we're in a society where there's a lot of new technology. And while we're happy that we can do so many things through the internet or through technology that makes life more productive, one concern we have is that sometimes we become so focused on our phones and on technology that we lose our interpersonal skills. You can walk to a room with 10 kids and all on their phones. And so one of the concerns we have is that people often become technology savvy. They can fax, they can email, they can really facilitate life through technology, but they lose the ability to communicate, to get along. So I think some of these activities that are being set forth tonight about camps and activities will also get people involved in interacting. And because we really think that in some ways we've lost our ability to communicate and get along well with people. So keep that in mind. Becky, what have you seen differently? You've been at your business for about 14 years. How is it different now than it was, let's say, in 2003?
Well, for the Parks Department, we used to do a lot of more programs with playgrounds and things like that. We don't do so many of those anymore, but we do a lot more environmental education programs and history-related programs. We find that doing environmental education programs is becoming more popular, and people are getting more into that kind of thing. Mm-hmm. But yeah, technology has definitely changed too.
One of the topics that comes up almost daily now is the idea of global warming. That supposedly our summers are warmer, our winters are warmer. There's a concern about what's happened to our air. Where are you guys on this? And there's no right or wrong answer. What are your thoughts about, especially Becky, since you're involved with some, what are some of the programs that you're involved with talk about climate
change? Some of the programs that we talk about? We're doing a program in June for kids, and it's going to be a science day where we're going to talk a little bit about pollution and solar energy and wind power and things like that, so they can kind of know what's going on with the earth and the environment around them.
And by the way, you need to consider yourselves lucky. My son and daughter-in-law live in Montgomery County, Maryland. And they are concerned in that particular county about plastic bags. So if you go to a store and make a purchase, if you buy food, if you go to a restaurant, they'll bag your food. But if you go to a grocery store and you need bags, they will charge you for the bags. So the whole purpose is to lessen the amount of plastic bags available. Being the cheapskate that I am, I always keep plastic bags in the car. When I go shopping down there, I take bags into the store so that I never buy the bags. And I think they're 5 cents a bag. And I guess if you could spend $40 or $50 for groceries, you could probably have 5 or 6 bags. So you're not going to spend more than 25 cents. But being the cheapskate that I am, I refuse to pay for bags. So And I'm amazed the number of bags I have here, you know, from typical shopping here in Reading. I have too many paper bags, or plastic bags, actually. So, but we are, there is a concern that we are destroying our earth. That and the other concern is that supposedly because the United States is a country that has more, we tend to make the biggest impact. And so it's a great responsibility on our part to keep our environment clean. Now, some people think it's a hoax, that it's not getting warmer. And of course, if you're one of those, then I guess you're not as concerned. I happen to have bought into this bit about global warming and about what's happening there. Now, we're talking about summer activities. And if you have questions, please feel free to call and ask, because we want you to have young people involved with lots of summer activities. But I'm going to ask Matt to talk about some of the things you guys do in fall, winter, and spring. Tonight, the focus is summer, and we hope that you'll ask about summer and focus on summer. But what else do you do the rest of the year?
During the course of the year, we have two main rec centers, one at 3rd and Spruce and one at 11th and Pike, and that operates after school from 3 to 8 o'clock. The 11th and Pike is for some of our smaller age children. We only go up until 6th grade, where 3rd and Spruce, basically it's from 3rd until 12th grade. Come in after school. We've been very fortunate. We received a grant from the National Parks and Recreation Association, which has allowed us to really feed the children and focus on nutrition. It's been a big focus of ours. The meals we give the kids, the snacks we give the kids, we've really tried to focus on that nutrition, because as you know, because of the technology, kids are doing less, they're exercising less. We need to get them out, we need to get them moving, but they also need to understand that the type of food they're putting in their body, what's healthy for them, what's not healthy. But that rec center, you can come after school, we give the kids a snack, they have their dinner there, and we run a plethora of activities. The gym's open to them, we have different clubs within our rec center. It could be an environmental club, it's our little ladies club, our young men's club, chess club. So there's a ton of activities for these kids to get involved in. And, you know, if you need a place for your child, you know, definitely a great place for you to be.
Great, great. What kind of things are you doing in fall, winter, and spring, Becky, in your program?
Well, we do a lot of outdoor programs, more in the fall and the winter. So we do things like cross-country skiing programs or things like that. We also do a holiday lights program in December down at Grings Mill. So we have lights and families come and look at the lights and things like that.
A lot of good activities.
Yeah.
Yeah. So while we may be out of school during the summer, you guys are busy all year round. There's something going on.
All year.
Yeah. And you even have winter outdoor activities. Well, cross-country skiing can be exciting. That sounds like that could be lots of fun to get involved on. I'll share with you that I have a concern about exercise. I was sharing with our two guests off camera that I jog almost every day for 30 years. And I found it really lessening stress. I used to try to, if there was something stressful, I tried to think about while I was jogging. I could not get stressed out while I was jogging. Also, because I love to eat all the wrong things, I got away with murder in terms of eating things I shouldn't be eating because I got the exercise. But about 8 years ago, I was told that I had all the cartilage gone on my knees. And so I had to stop jogging, and I've gone to swimming now. So, and I've been fortunate that my knees have not, I want to warn you, don't make my mistake and overdo it in terms of the running outdoors and the jogging, that swimming can be beneficial. I'm also told that walking is good. Now, I guess, Matt, because you're a swimming guru, swimming has been a life's godsend for you for all of your life, I guess. Yeah. And I guess you had water safety instruction and lessons and all those kinds of things.
And like I said, part of what we do in the winter as well, and I did mention swim lessons in the summer, but we also run those in the winter as well, run those out of Reading High School. So I think the biggest thing is getting the message out, because it seems like we have such a transient area, and so many people come in and they say, I had no idea that you had lessons, or I had no idea that the rec center was available, or trails and different things. And I think getting that information out, for as much as people are on technology, I think it's something that we still struggle with. Mm-hmm. I know we do. We direct people to the website, but a lot of times when folks move here, they're struggling initially to find out all the great opportunities. There's a lot of things to be done in and around Berks County that people can take advantage of. So, I mean, I know that Antietam Lake was just redone. Mm-hmm. Yeah. That's down by my house, and I can see that. The number of people that have been attending that, I come by it every day at home from work, has, to me, has risen. So that project they put down there has, I think, has been great.
Yeah, we try to encourage people to get out and go hiking and walking there. And we do dog walks there, so we encourage people to bring their dog and go on a walk, things like that.
Lots of good things. I'm going to talk a little bit about dieting, because that's been a concern, and I'll resort with the fact that everything that tastes good seems to be things I shouldn't be eating. But we're told that we eat too much meat, that Americans eat too much red meat, especially I think beef is not seen as not as counterproductive as pork, but red meat we should lessen the amount. And there's a fascinating story you may have heard that during World War II, when the Germans occupied Belgium, they took all their meat away. Did not allow them to have meat, the country to have meat. And during that time, when the Germans were occupying Belgium, heart disease went down. When the war was over, and they could go back to their sausage and their meats, heart disease went up. So we're not telling you to not eat meat at all, but we're saying that moderation is probably good. We're told that we should eat more vegetables, we should eat more fruits, we should avoid sugar. We should avoid white bread, and butter. So I'm probably breaking your heart. And ice cream, but again, in moderation. What I found is that when I eat these things in moderation, I appreciate them more. When I was younger, I could eat these things all the time. I think I took them for granted. So when I have a good steak now, I appreciate it more. But those are things we need to focus on. And I think both of your programs are often programs where people are exercising. I want you, Matt, to talk a little bit about weights. We talked earlier about the fact that there are some benefits from weights. And I think you're saying that they're different for swimmers as opposed to other people. And you're primarily a swimmer. But tell us a little bit about weights and what their purpose is and why they're used.
I think it's just like anything else. It's getting that exercise. We've really become a sit-down society. Mm-hmm. Technology society with computers and everything we do. So I think getting out and walking, getting out and swimming, getting to the weight room, doesn't necessarily mean you have to throw on, 200, 300 pounds of weight. It's about movement. It's just mm-hmm. about general resistance. I think it's just about getting out and get up and get moving. And I think that's one thing we encourage people to do. Mm-hmm. It's been a main focus at mm-hmm. our centers and in our summer programming. So much as when we have special events and we get pizza, it's not regular pizza anymore. It's got to be the wheat pizza. It's about teaching these kids mm-hmm. what about making good choices. Mm-hmm. We have a great, and one program I do want to mention is our Chef Sprout program, which is a program we run with Chef Tony out of our rec centers. And what he does is he uses ingredients that he can get at the local corner stores, because that's where a lot of our young people are shopping. Uh-huh. And he's showing us how you can make healthy meals. It doesn't always have to be unhealthy meals. So he uses ingredients that he can purchase locally and teaches these kids that, yes, you can make good meals, you can make healthy meals just around the corner. And uh-huh. I think that's been surprising. It's opened my eyes, uh-huh. some of the things that they can do. I know a few times I'm a very picky eater. Anybody knows me knows I'm a very picky eater. But they've given me a few meals where I was like, I don't know about this. Didn't taste too bad. Uh-huh. So I think it's a great program. If you want to get involved in it, we did run a Saturday program for not only the kids but adults if they wanted to come in and learn more about it. Uh-huh. And like I said, you can still call the rec center if you're interested in something like that. We're not going to run it over the summer, but it's going to come back in the fall with our centers, and you can call us at the 610-655-6201. That's our main office number. And find out some great things about it.
Sounds great. I've also learned that there's some substitutes. For example, we like pasta, we like bread, we like potatoes. I found that I can do wheat pasta, I can do wheat bread, and I found a new potato called purple potatoes, which tastes to me just like regular potatoes, but I'm sold a little healthier. So some of the things we adore and love, we can find ways to get around, and protein is always a concern. And I've heard people take, they can take soy and have beet taste like to them. So some things we can do, I guess, to be healthy and to stay healthy. We're also told that we can walk more. For example, if you're able, you can walk up the steps instead of taking the elevator. We can walk more places. You know, we tend to jump in our cars, and they're convenient. And I should have been walking all the years I was jogging. I might still have the cartridge in my knees, and still walking is just as good. So there are all kinds of things we can do to lengthen our lives. We're living longer, and some of the things that we're encountering now are because we live longer. That people in the mean age at the turn of the 19th century or 20th century may have been 60. We now live longer than that, and of course we then again run difficulty because we're living longer, but we all want to live better and healthier. Little things we can keep in mind. You mentioned that there are some astrological programs with astronomy that are involved, mm-hmm. and so that's great. Most of your programs, Matt, are in the city. Whereas I guess most of yours back here are outside the city. So are you, for the most part, in Muhlenberg?
Our programs, they're at one of our parks. So they're either out at Grings Mill, the Berks County Heritage Center, the Union Canal Towpath. The Parks Department runs programs at the Bidler House on Route 724. Uh-huh. And then, like you said, out at Antietam Lake Park, that's their newest place to run programs. So we're all a little bit of everywhere in Berks County.
Now, you mentioned a Christmas lights program. Mm-hmm. What's that like?
We do a program in December. It's called Holiday Lights, and they put up lights. And then each night, it's Wednesday through Sunday, they have music in the top of the barn there. Uh-huh. It's different bands each night. And then people can walk down and look at the lights. And then go downstairs to our snack bar. We can get hot chocolate and pretzels and things. And we do a craft weekend where we have kids come in and they get to make something for the trees or something.
What would you say is your most popular summer activity? All the things you guys plan in the summer, which one do you think is the most popular?
Of our bigger programs?
Yes.
It's probably our... Kite Day that we do. It's sort of the end of April towards the beginning of May, and that's one of our bigger programs. You can come and you can fly your kites. And
Is there any kind of competition in that, though, or is it just fly the kites and see what?
Kids can make kites. They get a chance to make kites and decorate them, and then they judge them best on. You can also make a kite out of newspaper and enter it into the newspaper contest. As long as it flies, you're good.
I'm always amazed, the skill to get the kite way up there. Mm-hmm. And the guys know what they're doing. They don't have to, I have just to run with mine, you know.
Yeah.
But the guys who know how the wind works and how to set them up can stand right there and they're up. Of course, they give a little more string.
Yeah.
So that's always exciting. I guess my biggest fear in summer are water activities and boating activities. I guess you guys aren't involved in any boating activities at all, are you?
I am not.
No. We do some kayak programs. We just go down, mostly down the Tulpahockan Creek, which is a pretty easy place to go down. You fall out, it's not that deep. We don't do things on the Schuylkill River so much, but...
But they're awesome.
And when we do boating activities, you have to wear your PFDs or your life jackets and have some skill level.
Yeah. Now, I guess, Matt, in addition to getting lessons on how to swim, I guess you can get lessons on how being a lifeguard or water safety instructor.
We actually just finished. Part of what I do is we certify. We run a certification class every spring. Obviously, there's a lot of pools looking to hire, and so we run that certification class out of Reading High School. It's about a 26-hour commitment if you want to become a certified lifeguard. I will say that I keep telling kids it's a great opportunity. Don't come get certified because you think you're going to get a tan. But if you really want an opportunity to work, because it seems like there is a shortage. I've had a lot of pools call me and say, hey, do you have any extra guards? So we do run that class every spring in May up at the high school, and it's a great opportunity for kids to get employment then through the summer. And in some cases, you do even have an opportunity throughout the winter. There's opportunities at places like the Body Zone, the YMCA, that have indoor pools that need lifeguards. It's a great opportunity to continue your work.
Now, you said it's 26 hours. Is it spread over 26 weeks? Or
no, we did it for 5 weeks consecutively. So it just varies. Some do them in a weekend. They do 2 weekends. But it's not too bad of a class. But you do follow, you know, we teach the American Red Cross, so there is a curriculum that needs to be followed. So it's a great opportunity for the kids to get out. And then part of the lesson program is obviously not just teaching them how to swim, but just being safe around the water.
Mm-hmm. Now, when I was a lifeguard back in the Stone Age, I worked mostly around pools. If a person is trained under your program to be a lifeguard, are they given instructions on how to work around beaches also? Or?
There's different certification levels. We just teach the basic lifeguarding, but there is a waterfront class that can be added on. That's not something that I teach and most around here don't teach, but you can get the add-on. The other things you can do, you know, I'm a WSI, which is a water safety instructor. That basically is a program so you know how to teach kids how to swim, and the Body Zone does a great job with offering some of those classes. That's not something I do, but they certify some water safety instructors out there as well. So it's an important thing. It's very important that, like I said, this time of summer, unfortunately we read the paper here and there, and there's just always seems to be unfortunate accidents. And I just really encourage, you know, families, get your kids involved somehow if you're going to be around a body of water.
Now, I was certified as a lifeguard, but my son took it a step further as a water safety instructor, which means that he can actually teach people to swim, I guess.
That's right, right. Yeah, so it's a water safety instructor is through the American Red Cross, so it is a little bit different and compared to a lifeguard. As long as you have someone overseeing the program, the lesson program, who is certified, you can implement that American Red Cross program.
Now, you said that the lifeguard program is about 5 weeks, or 26.
So right.
Water safety is probably a little further, I guess.
Yeah, it's been a little while since I did that, but they're about similar, your commitment. So, you know, I think it's a great opportunity.
Sure. For employment.
Sure.
And the fascinating thing is that I never pulled anybody out. You sit and watch, I'm sure that there are occasions when you have to, but... I think the real thing is prevention.
That's the best thing. I mean, I oversee the Schlegel Park, and I will say that my staff is very active. We've probably made at least 6 saves this year, but that's important. I really encourage them to be active, and you don't ever want to hesitate, because hesitation and a lack of response can get you in a little bit more trouble and put the victim in a little bit tougher position. So we always try to teach proactive. Obviously, prevention is the number one, but you know, it's not easy. It's not easy always to identify initially when people come in. So we just ask parents, when you take your kids to the pool, yes, the lifeguards are there in any pool. They're there for your safety, but they're not there to watch just your child. We're to watch the whole entire pool. So, you know, I think one of the things that I see, and you asked me how things have changed, I think that's one of the things. They think the lifeguards are there to make those saves. They're really not. You need to watch your children. We're there if there is truly an accident. You know, we're there to respond. But you have a personal responsibility to, you know, if you're bringing your kids to a body of water, to make sure that you're attentive towards them.
Now, this I'm going back 50 years, but one of the things that we had, we always had someone who would dive into shallow water and get serious back or neck injuries. I swim regularly at the Y now. They're always saying, no diving in the shallow end. But I guess that's still a concern, though, because...
It is, and you know, every pool has those areas marked. Mm-hmm. But at the end of the day, if someone's not paying attention, you know, accidents can happen, unfortunately. But that's why you have trained personnel around. But at the end of the day, it's all about prevention. It's all about education. It's about making sure your patrons know where they can and cannot do certain things in order to keep them safe. Uh-huh. So it is really a team effort when you're out around a body of water.
And that's the prevention, I guess. Mm-hmm. I also was fascinated that we have an old saying, and it's probably obsolete now, you row or throw before you go. And oftentimes, I guess sometimes a person who's in distress isn't aware, but we can throw something to them and pull them in.
That's how it's actually still taught. With the Red Cross, is as a guard, you actually should not go in if you don't have to, if you can reach them without going in. Because anytime you have a victim and someone else goes in, you can be that victim. Yeah. You can add to that, you know, now we have two victims. So, you know, you always want to throw before you go.
And people have drowned lifeguards, kind of, you know, they're excited. And so we would even practice how to turn them around.
Escapes and get away.
Which is a major concern in terms of, we're always concerned about water safety. And the deep end versus the shallow end, you know. And again, learning to swim is a lifesaver for people.
Absolutely.
And of course, I guess you can't start too young.
Nope. I think just being safe around the water, educating your kids as to where they can and can't go, and I think that's always, it's a preventative measure that we all need to be aware of.
Now, my kids started when they were like 1 and 2 years old. I'm always fascinated that kids that young know how to hold their breath. I guess it's instinctive.
The Red Cross has a mommy and me or a parent class. They do try to start them fairly young.
Uh-huh.
So I think it's just about acclimating your kids to the water. Because I will say that even this winter, we had some adults coming up for our lessons asking to get lessons for themselves. Here's folks in their 30s or 40s and 50s saying, I still don't know how to swim.
Uh-huh.
And they want to be safe around the water because their kids are.
Sure.
So it's one of the things that we've starting to see a little bit more of a request to have parents and get some education for them around the water.
Yeah. And it's fascinating also that sometimes that when you're older, you get fears that don't exist when you're younger, and they can get in and get started earlier. I guess it doesn't matter. I had one coach who didn't want parents around when he was teaching the kids. I don't know why, but what his reasoning was. But it's really fascinating that it's a very important skill. And we hope that you'll take advantage of it this summer and get our people out safely, because we are the young people are our future, and they're the ones who are going to be leaders of tomorrow, and if they're safe and happy. And also, I'm a big believer in self-esteem, that being active, being involved, builds self-esteem, you got to feel good about yourself. And I'm always important. It's important to me to emphasize the fact that self-esteem is not arrogance. That the people who really feel good with themselves can be humble. But usually the guy who has this I'm the man facade is really covering up. And sometimes we mistake. And I've even had a situation where I have had students who I thought had such an air of confidence. And I mistakenly mistook that for real confidence, because I gave them challenges that really unnerved them. And had I understood the fact that sometimes the exterior is not really what's underneath. And then we've had people who are very soft-spoken and very gentle, and we think they're shy, and they aren't always shy. But so sometimes we can't judge a book by its cover, or a person by the facade or the surface. We're lucky to have Becky and Matt here. And we're almost out of time, but if you have any questions, you can call us at 610-378-0426. If there's anything you need to know about what you can do with your young people this summer, they're here to just help and serve. And I have a few minutes, so I'm going to read off some programs that could not be here tonight, but and their numbers, if you want to take advantage of some of them. Now, oftentimes we think of summer activities as involved with sports and outdoor, but there's some other activities I want you to be aware of. There's a community school of music and the arts at the Garble Works on the fifth floor. Their number is 610-374-7167. Again, that's the Garble Works, music and the arts, fifth floor, 610-374-7167. There's Colonial Summer Day Camps in Sinking Spring at 610-777-9651. There's Camps for Tara, which is in Bethel. Their number is 717-933-8510. There's the Conrad Weiser Camp, and you can reach them at 610-670-2267. There's the Camp I Cook Young Chefs Academy. That sounds exciting. Call them at 610-376-3634. There's Camp Calvary in Burnville, 717-933-8902. Camp Adventure, this is Camp Adventure at Albright College. Their number is 610-929-4775. Camp Adol in Moncton at 610-856-7250. The Body Zones Sports and Fitness Program, 610-376-2100. And of course, with luck, we have Berks County Parks and Recreation here. Their number is 610-374-8839. The Berks Ballet Theater Dance Company has a summer camp. Their number is 610-373-7577. And of course, we've talked about Sherwood and Spruce Summer Camp. Their number is 610-857-5149. I also want to remind our viewing audience that I like to think of these monthly programs, the second Monday of each month, are programs that are designed for the community. And if you think you have an idea that I may not be thinking of, that I may not be doing, give me a call. It'll be on the screen in a few minutes, but it's 610-372-5049. In July, I'm going to do one of my favorite activities. That's the second Monday in July. I love to bring on amateur musicians and amateur poets. So if you're a poet and have written a poem but you'd like to come on and recite on live with us, give me a call, 610-372-5049. And if you're a musician, same thing is true, 610-372-5049. Of course, now, the musicians are a little greater challenge because you need to bring your instrument with you. And it's not as easy to set up as it were in the old studio. So if you're a guitarist, it's pretty simple to do. But keep in mind that setting up can be a challenge for musicians. We're almost out of time. Any final comments from either Becky or Matt? I think you've talked out. please take advantage of their activities. I wish you would, Matt, give your number again, if you would.
Yeah, you can call us at 610-655-6201 or go to our website, which has all our activities all year long, any changes, any ads we have, and that's www.readingrec.org.
Becky, your number again, please.
It's 610-374-8839. And if you want to know all our programs, just pick up one of our program books. They're all throughout.
They're all around.
Or go on our website.
We just want to be happy, healthy during the summer. And as a matter of fact, the next 2 days are going to be very hot days. And so people will be in the pools. And one of the questions I asked Matt before the show was, what temperature should you keep your pools? And he told me that 78 is probably ideal for swimmers and or competitive folks and people who are ballet or people who are doing aerobics, even a little warmer.
Correct.
It's amazing to me that if the temperature is 85 or 90 degrees outside, we're complaining. But if it gets much colder than that in the water, we're complaining. And of course, that's probably revolves around the fact that our body temperature is about 98.6. So if we think of our bodies at being at 98.6, then it's understandable that we are subjective about how the water feels based on that body temperature. If it gets into the 70s, we're complaining. In low 70s, really complaining about how cold it is. And yet, a 70-degree temperature outside is ideal. They talk about, I think it's San Diego, where it's 70 degrees all year round. And that's a big difference. Now, Matt, at one time, you did a lot of pool activity in Florida, where the weather's warmer.
Correct.
Did you have a big difference in terms of your activities and how you handled that in terms of here?
Well, I think it's just, we kind of alluded to it, is those that are doing more of a slower type thing, maybe an aqua aerobic, or some of our seniors, they tend to like the water warmer.
Uh-huh.
They're maybe not exerting as high a activity rate, so they like it. They like to be comfortable.
Uh-huh.
Where if you're a competitor and you're just like if you're running a sprint race compared to walking, your body temperature changes, so you want it a little bit cooler.
Uh-huh. There are some things that I remember doing years ago that I would not recommend. I remember, I guess I was in my, it was about 20, 19 or 20, I would play basketball for an hour or so, and then really be dripping in sweat, and then go dive in the pool. I don't recommend that. Sometimes we feel that it's such a relief, it's so exhilarating, but extreme body temperature can cause all kinds of problems. And of course, depending on the temperature of the pool, as I look back now, I was playing with fire with those kind of activities. The other thing I think that I really appreciated, you know, as a younger person, was just learning to tread water. I remember we had a drill in high school where we had to tread water for 3 or 4 minutes, and it seemed like forever.
Yes.
And then we had to do like a 5 or 10 minute swim. We were actually moving the entire time. And all these kind of activities prepare us for, I guess, a real concern, especially for those who go into Schuylkill or Currents, and just staying afloat. We've also talked about riptides and oceans and being careful. I was always told that if there's a sudden rise in the water, you know, let's say you're at a beach and the water's at your chest level, and suddenly a wave comes in, that you're better off swimming parallel to the shore, I'm told, as opposed to directly in or out. And I guess the most important thing is to stay calm, because oftentimes we can panic and not be very far from the shore or from help. The other concern I had, we mentioned earlier, and again, I'm concerned about safety, is that oftentimes if you're in distress, they can throw something to you, and as opposed to coming to get you. And we are sometimes our own worst enemies if we panic. If we can stay calm, I can remember swallowing large amounts of water, choking, and Coach told me, "Breathe out of your nose." And for some reason, overwhelmed with so much water in the rear of my nose seemed to solve the problem. But getting myself to calm down and do that was the overwhelming challenge. And of course, that's always a concern, is that in any situation, it's remaining calm and remind ourselves that we are emotional beings. And I think we men are oftentimes more guilty of that, not admitting that we're emotional beings. I think somehow in our society, we've given women license to be emotional. And we're emotional also. And I think if we know we're emotional and prepare for that, then in times of stress and emotion, then we can prepare for it by knowing that, and they're saying, know thyself, know it, but excite you, but get you going, and then how can I calm down? And that's important, especially around water. Well, folks, we're just about out of time, but I want to remind you to take advantage of all these activities, get the kids involved, get them outside, and please, while I'm happy they have these phones, I'm happy they have their computers, get them involved with interaction. we still place a great amount of importance in interpersonal skills. And a great, as a psychologist, fear I have now is that with all of our technology, we sometimes lose our ability to really interact and have interpersonal skills. We're out of time. Good night. Thanks for viewing, staying with us. Good night. God bless.